My name is Tiffany Spraggins Payne. You are listening to Zigzag, a weekly podcast discussing women in science, technology, transportation, engineering, entrepreneurship, mathematics, and related industries. On Zigzag, we discuss inclusion and diversity news, current trends, and have special guests speak about their experiences, including their competitive edge in the marketplace.
Hello, everyone. This is Ryan Martin, the producer for the Grit Studios. It was just announced that Girl Develop It won $50,000 from the WeWork Creator Awards. Girl Develop It is a nonprofit dedicated to teaching women about technology, helping them enter the industry, and providing a sense of community. You might remember Girl Develop It from episode 21 because Suzie Nieman is actually the co-lead for Girl Develop It's Philadelphia chapter. In honor of this awesome victory, we decided to re-air her episode. So here it is again, episode 21, Overcoming Imposter Syndrome with Suzie Nieman. We really hope you enjoy the episode, and please enjoy me in congratulating Girl Develop It on this awesome accomplishment.
Thank you so much for coming on today, Suzie.
Thank you, Tiffany. It's so great to be here.
Oh, I'm so happy to have you. We had some incredible conversation offline. I'm really stoked about having this conversation with you today because, you know, like myself and many, many other women who chime in to the Zigzag podcast are self-starters. Mm-hmm. And so in your own words, I would love for you to talk about what your definition of a self-starter might be.
Yeah, absolutely. And thank you for that.
You're welcome.
I think that to me, a self-starter is someone who is not expecting someone else to kind of come in and swoop in and save them or to provide them the answer. It's someone who, you know, accepts that they need to put in the work and they need to create their own opportunities. And, you know, in those moments where the door opens, you know, you run right through, you know, without looking back, because success is, you know, not the opposite of failure, but kind of one in the same path.
I think that's awesome. I'm just going to commandeer your definition, if that's okay, because you're a self-starter. You have a very unique background and path. So, you know, I would love for you to tell our audience, you know, how did you get started in the computing tech industry to begin with?
Yeah. Well, it all started on neopets.com when I was modifying my profile to be different colors, to have different glitter banners, you know, using HTML and CSS. What I didn't know is that those skills I was learning on my own were going to become extremely marketable in the very near future, and found out about a coffee shop in Cincinnati named Rocks Electro Cafe. They are hybrid coffee shop and PC gaming center. They needed a website. They were just opening. So I raised my hand, and you know, I'd done basic HTML, CSS, wasn't super familiar beyond that, but I let them know that I could do it, and I sat down and I made a really ugly but functional WordPress website for them, and it was, you know, the first piece of my portfolio in the front-end development world. From there, I just kept trying to, you know, improve my skills as it came to my knowledge that so many people needed a website. The supply was not meeting the demand by any means, and so that's kind of really the very first lifting off point for me. When I realized that I could be on the computer and I could get paid for it.
Yes.
It wasn't just all, you know, video games.
I think that's awesome. You know, what was some advice that you received during that time when you kind of like launched out and did this on your own?
Yeah, I would say first and foremost was how many times I heard that technology was the future, that, you know, IT, coding,
yes,
very marketable. I didn't really understand at the time how that would translate into a profession. But I heard that advice from people much older than me
yes,
many times, and I believed them. And I'd say, secondarily, you need to not be afraid to create your own opportunities.
Yes.
The golden ticket from Charlie's Chocolate Factory isn't going to show up at your door. You kind of need to step out there and make yourself known, put your name out there, and see where there are opportunities for you to build something like a website or provide your other consultative services to someone, even if they're not necessarily asking. because the worst thing that can happen is you get a no, you get a rejection, and that's okay.
Yes. And what I think is so interesting about you is that, you know, you have a natural knack for project management. You know, and we all know that project management translates to any sector, like any industry. And so I want you to talk about, you know, how you went from the place where you were in 2008, just really testing the waters around, you know, coding and computing and all of that, to actually becoming a technical project manager that you are right now for Four Kitchens.
Yeah. When I built that first website, it really sparked something in me because I have always been someone that loves to be on the internet, who loves to be playing games online.
Yes.
And that light bulb that this could become my income, this could become a real career, it set off a pretty intense amount of passion and excitement because up until then, nothing had really sparked that kind of feeling for me.
Yes.
At the time, there were countless Craigslist ads, countless job postings online for people that needed a website and people that didn't need this big platform. They just needed a small, like, branding website. Like, I did many websites for my friends that were trying to create their online portfolios. I would make websites for friends who had their own businesses, say, a small dog walking company. That was kind of the beginning, and I was getting way less than I deserved for what I was doing at the time, but that was how I was able to start my portfolio and build out my portfolio. Moving to Philadelphia in 2012 was really one of the biggest catalysts for me launching myself into this career. I thought I was going to go to New York City. I actually worked for a couple of companies based out of New York and would commute up there, and I really just fell in love with Philadelphia and the tech community here.
Yes.
Being a part of the co-working space Indie Hall has provided me with a lot of different connections. I was able to see many different approaches to making money in the technology world beyond development. I tried to dabble in social media marketing. Wasn't for me. Copywriting, not the greatest at that.
Okay.
I came upon a posting for a digital project manager. Being someone that had been managing website projects of my own, small, not comparable to the work that they were going to be asking me to do, but enough to say, hey, I know how to keep things on the budget I committed to. I know how to deliver the work on time. The amount of fear and anxiety of going into those interactions and the imposter syndrome was real. But I just had to keep reminding myself, the worst thing that could happen is I get a rejection. Hopefully, a rejection I can learn from. And this was probably the 20th project management role I had applied for. It was contract.
Okay.
And they brought me on. It was like I had found something that I could do for a living that felt like the back of my hand, really. Because I've always been an organizer. I'm always the one planning the parties for, you know, my friends when I was a kid.
Yes.
Leading organizations in school. I just love to plan things.
Yes.
It's exciting to me. And so that was another light bulb moment, just like when I started coding, that companies need people like that to keep their budgets and their timelines and their people happy. That really opened my eyes to what project management was. And I was able to learn immensely from the woman that was working at this company already and see how she did it. And then I got another contract gig with a different company, and I was able to see how they did it, and I was able to start to try out improvements.
Yes.
In those small startup company environments, there's so much room to make your mark. That was a huge learning experience. I'm very grateful for those opportunities because then I was able to start to build out my project management portfolio, which is very different than a web development portfolio.
Still
requires experience. And yes, so I can sit down right now, pull open my text editor and start to build something, upload it to GitHub, and there, you know, I have a piece of my portfolio. Not to say that that's an easy step by any means, but it's something that I have a lot of control over. With project management, you need to have the project given to you in some fashion. Now, that project can take so many different forms. If you're planning a wedding, you're project managing, you know, you're event planning, you are making sure you hit a budget, do things by certain dates so that you are not missing your target. I think that it's harder to get that first opportunity versus web development. I think it was easier because I was able to build a portfolio all out myself like that.
And so what I really appreciate about you and how courageous you were, you know, coming from Cincinnati in 2012 to Philadelphia, you have managed to hook up with Girl Develop It, which is a volunteer-based organization. And for our listeners, I'm just going to basically share what the core mission of Girl Develop It is, okay? So Girl Develop It is a nonprofit organization that exists to provide affordable and judgment-free opportunities for women interested in learning web and software development. Through in-person classes and community support, Girl Develop It helps women of diverse backgrounds achieve their technology goals and build on their confidence in their careers, in everyday lives. And there's so many different meetup groups, so many different organizations to choose from. Why did you choose Girl Develop It and what made you stay so long?
That's a great question. So, funny story, I actually discovered Girl Develop It Cincinnati.
Oh.
One of the many things I was attempting to earn an income off of was photography. Okay. And so I offered to take photos of their intro to HTML and CSS class.
Awesome.
Just to get my foot in the door somehow, even though I didn't feel at the time I was qualified to teach or TA. Then when I moved here, I looked up the same organization, and I, at that point, felt like I was ready to start TAing classes.
Okay.
I was drawn to Girl Develop It Philly even more so because it's one of the most active chapters in the country, which is really impressive when you think about it in Philadelphia in the context of the technology industry in the nation, that there are so many women here that are so excited to learn new skills, to transition into a technology career. When I walked into that first class, it was a different energy from other meetups that I had been to, which really captivated me. The focus on in-person classes and in a community setting really was what hooked me on GDI. The people in the GDI community really genuinely want to help each other. And I think that that also reflects back on the Philadelphia technology community. There is a true desire to lift one another up and to provide opportunities for those who have not been afforded them here in this city.
Yes.
And I think it really shone through in the first classes and meetups that I participated in.
You have managed to kind of grow your volunteerism role to now being the co-lead and a teacher for Girl Develop It Philly chapter. Talk about that journey, you know, since coming to Philadelphia, how you've shaped that role for yourself.
Yes, absolutely. Having been in positions where I'm working from home most of the time, having a tether to the Philadelphia tech scene in an in-person way has been transformational over the last several years that I've been involved with the organization.
Okay.
And when they put out a call for a new organizer, I was all over it. I bet if I went back and looked at those emails, I was probably going on and on about how much I wanted to get involved.
Yes.
And they chose me and a couple other women to bring on at that time as into the organizer role.
Okay.
It has been incredible to see the continued growth and the baton being passed from chapter leader to chapter leader to chapter leader over the course of the last 7 years. And to see the amount of impact that we've been able to have on actual people and their lives. We heard success stories from women in our community that came to a meetup. Maybe their background was in art history. Maybe their background was in retail. Maybe their background was in something completely unrelated to technology. They were able to use our group as a launching off point to become self-starters of their own.
Wow.
And to change careers, to see through our organization that it's possible.
Yes.
Because I think that the message that it is not possible is what is portrayed, but we are here to tell people that it is possible. You can learn these skills. You can absolutely learn to code.
Yes.
You can absolutely learn to market yourself and your value.
Yes.
And you are not alone in that journey. There are people here who are rooting for you and who are here to pick you up when you fall down and here to give you the resources that you need.
I think that's awesome because when I think about a recent study that I've read put out by the National Center for Women and Information Technology, they state that 26% of women work in the computing workforce. That was according to their 2013 stats. Of that, they break it down. They say 3% of the women working in the computing workforce is Black women, 5% were Asian, and 2% were Hispanic. And so as you talk about, you know, the diverse community, I just, you know, stated a stat that deals with the ethnicity of the different women who are working in the computing space. But, you know, I love how you touched on there were women coming from different industry sectors, bringing that knowledge along, bringing that experience along into the classroom setting. How often do you guys facilitate sessions?
We have, on average, 4 to 7 classes per quarter that we offer. We start with fundamentals like web concepts, intro to HTML and CSS, intro to JavaScript, and it ranges to resume review, salary negotiation workshops, interview workshops, panels of women that have changed careers to tell their story. Megan Kelly on our team recently just hosted a career changer panel for Philly Tech Week, and it was emotional in the best way, hearing those women up there confident, talking about the real hard stuff in their journey, and putting that out there to a room full of people that may not have had the confidence when they walked in, but left with this excitement and this knowledge that it is possible for them to make that kind of change too.
So, Suzie, what is your no-fail go-to when you need inspiration and creativity?
I would say changing my environment is my go-to. I love to travel as much as I possibly can, and when that's not an option, because that's always the easiest fix, but when that's not an option, just going outside to a different part of Philadelphia.
Okay.
Going to West Philly and hanging out in the park with my dogs.
Okay.
Seeing a friend for coffee out there, just changing the scenery, changing what I'm doing, getting some sunshine, being around some people, just shutting off from whatever obstacle that I'm up against that I can't seem to get past, giving myself a break, and then returning more energized. I will kind of come to more of those moments of clarity and creativity once I have stopped trying to make them happen. You know, not always, but a lot of the time when I'm out trying to take a break, that's when the spark of insight hits me.
That's awesome. So essentially it's like self-care first.
Yes. I am big about the self-care first attitude. I think it's extremely important to be able to produce your best results.
That is, we are in sync. Even though I'm not always great at it.
It's harder,
It's much harder. But with that being said, I want you to talk a little bit about some tools. This is actually a loaded question. So what are some tools, objects, and rituals you cannot live without as you go throughout your workday?
Meditation is absolutely the number one on my list. Okay. I find that it grounds me and it calms me down so that I can approach things with a clearer head.
Yes.
And if I don't do my meditation, I feel it on the day that I missed it.
Okay.
I would also say that tasks and task management tools.
Okay. Because you're a project technical project manager.
Yes. I have accepted that my human brain is faulty when it comes to remembering literally everything. So I export my brain to the cloud a little bit, and I have a series of reminders and to-do lists that I have that I look at every day that I use to manage what I'm doing. So as far as tools, I'm using a Google Doc that has different sections for the different projects that I'm working on to keep track of tasks. And I use a reminder system called TickTick for things like taking a medication or making sure I take out the trash the right night, pay a credit card bill. That way I can save my brain power for the work that I need to do that day.
Yes.
And I'm eliminating the amount of open loops that I have going on in my mind.
Talk about how you've been able to identify future trends, you know, in the marketplace around tech, leveraging the work that you're doing with Girl Develop It.
I've definitely seen a huge trend toward technology professionals that have not started off in college with that intention, that may not have a bachelor's degree, that may have a bachelor's degree or further in something unrelated to technology, that are taking that opportunity to pivot and to figure out what in tech is right for them and to find those full-time opportunities after putting in the work over a period of time to get there. I'm seeing that happening more and more. And I would also say that I have seen a trend in the amount of women and minorities that are getting involved in the technology industry. I think over the last couple of years, there's been a 2% increase in the amount of women holding computing positions. That is, you know, we're still not where we were in 1991 when it was a 36%. But the fact that we are seeing an increase in the last few years is great news. And I do, in my day-to-day life, anecdotally, I am seeing more women, more people of color, more genderqueer people than I've ever seen before stepping up and learning these skills and getting jobs as developers, as UX strategists, you name it.
I think that's fantastic. You know, one of the things I fully appreciate about you sharing your journey is that, you know, as we were preparing for today's interview, you know, there were some moments of self-doubt, some adversity you've had to overcome. Tell our audience about how you've been able to, in those moments where, you know, maybe you were ready to throw.
Part of the game, part of the package, and
I don't want to do this tech thing anymore. You know, how did you build yourself back up when you experienced those moments?
Yes, I have certainly experienced many of those moments, and it is, therefore, the first thing that I focus on is that feeling of connectedness to others.
Yes.
That I am on this path. There have been others on this path before me. Others will join this path after me.
Yes.
And we are all going to face unique but similar struggles, and we're all going to have the moments where we are not feeling like we can get back up.
Yes.
And remembering that I am not alone.
I think you're really hitting the nail on the head there. And I want you to talk about or name a fear or professional challenge that kept you up at night and how you've been able to lean into your community to deal with that, whatever that challenge might have been.
Well, it's funny you say that. I would say one of the biggest ones for me has been public speaking, and not just specifically public speaking, but crystallizing my thoughts and my feelings and my ideas into tangible recommendations, blog posts, anything that involves me saying, I, Suzie Nieman, know what I am talking about has been hard for me. And I think it comes from imposter syndrome, from my background kind of being a little all over the place at the beginning. And now that I've gotten my foothold and I know what I want to be doing for a living and I feel that I'm very good at what I do for a living, taking that next step into that confidence and to really truly lean in and believe in myself has been a challenge that has kept me up at night and has caused me some anxiety.
Wow.
And I would say that, you know, going right back to what we were talking about with the community.
Yes.
Girl Develop at Philly is a great example of a community that has really helped to lift me up and to remind me I know what I'm talking about and that I have a voice that deserves to be heard. And I think
in teaching, you know, one of your new adopters,
feel good about yourself and removing those from your life that are making you feel bad and that are bringing you down is one of the most transformational things that I've been able to do to help myself overcome that.
You know, talk about, you know, how you've learned from perhaps a mistake. A girl develop it, and how a mistake perhaps led to a success, both for you and for the new adopter in Girl Develop It.
Yeah, teaching with Girl Develop It is an amazing learning experience because you are, for the most part, creating the curriculum from the ground up.
Yes.
Which is, like, teaching is indeed one of the best ways to learn. The first time that we ever taught our digital project management class, I co-teach with Jessica Victor, and we had some mistakes that happened during that class. I think we had some inaccurate pricing data on some of our slides. You know, we had an exercise that we had tried to practice ourselves, but it was a little bit too advanced for the classroom. When we put it into practice, there was a lot of confusion. You know, at the time, it felt horrible. It felt like I had failed. You know, it felt like I let this classroom down.
Yes.
And why? Who do I think, you know, to be up here teaching? But we sat back down. We learned from the mistakes that we made in that first session, and we didn't stop teaching. We fixed the problems with the curriculum and added some new things to the curriculum that we hadn't even thought to add because students had raised their hands in class saying, asking us questions.
Yes.
And so it led to a moment of feeling like maybe we shouldn't be doing this for me. But then I was able to say, no, this is the process.
Yes.
And now I can look back and see that we have taught the class probably 7 times now.
Awesome.
And it's like the back of our hand. The curriculum has evolved. And now the curriculum that we have today would not be nearly as successful if we didn't make those mistakes.
Yes.
If we had, it certainly wouldn't have reached its success if we let those mistakes define us.
Yes.
But, you know, even though it felt embarrassing and it was in a public setting, you can't let that stuff get in the way of learning from your mistakes, because that is one of the most valuable things about making a mistake, is that you can learn from that and apply it. And, you know, like we were talking about before, picking yourself back up and continuing to go forward.
Yeah. So Suzie, I mean, this has really been a great dialogue to have with you. You know, how might you define success?
That's for a deep one for me.
For yourself. And then answer it for Girl Develop It.
For me personally, success is being satisfied with myself and loving myself and giving back to those around me. Finding that place of self-acceptance and self-love and bringing that energy into the work that I do, into the communities around me, to help other people to feel lifted up when they are down, and kind of that back and forth of lifting each other up and helping each other when I'm down, you know, she's helping me, when she's down, I'm helping her.
Yes.
Kind of that to me is a successful life. But for Girl Develop at Philly, success really looks like a community where you can learn and take classes and find people that you can build relationships with. To me, Girl Develop It is successful when it goes beyond Girl Develop It.
Mm-hmm.
We have women that have formed their own Python study group that meet weekly to work on that now. We have people that have helped other people in our community get jobs. And someone said, hey, on Slack, might have said, hey, I'm looking for this kind of role.
Yes.
To me, success is when our community is empowered and able to reach out to that kind of person and help them and give them, you know, some job opportunities that they know of, and that it's kind of beyond, you know, I'm just one person. Our team is just 4 people. Success for me is that the community is kind of its own thing, and that the community is driving success too, right along with us.
Yes.
Where we're all supporting each other and we're all in this together.
I think that's awesome.
For those who are listening and they want to learn more about Girl Develop It and they want to connect with you, how can I get in touch with you?
For Girl Develop It, we have a Slack channel that's very active that I would recommend you join. We also have our meetup group. So if you'd like to be added to the Slack channel, you can reach out to me directly, Suzie at girldevelopit.com. And I can get you added to that Slack channel. You can find our meetup if you just Google Girl Develop It Philly Meetup, and that's where we post all of our events, classes, etc. And I'm also on Twitter at SuzieNieman, Suzie Nieman.
Today my guest was Suzie Nieman, who works as a full-time technical project manager for 4 Kitchens. She's also the co-lead at Girl Develop It Philly. Suzie translates vision into clear plan in action. She is a process whisperer and a task destroyer. That is her trademark. And she has spent 5 years managing a multitude of digital projects and is a certified Scrum Master. Outside of 4 Kitchens, she has led and organized and is a teacher for Girl Develop It Philly and cares deeply about increasing diversity within the tech industry. My name is Tiffany Spraggins Payne, and I'm signing off.
Hello everyone, this is Ryan Martin, the producer and sound engineer for The Grit Studios. If you enjoy our podcasts, the most important thing you can do to support us is share this episode with your family and friends and let us know what you think about it in the comments. And don't forget to subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, or wherever you find your podcasts. Subscribing is 100% free. Don't know how to subscribe? Don't worry about it. There's a video walking you through the process in the show notes below. We will see you next week, and thank you for listening.